Dear friends, today we will discuss about Tibetan poetry in English. Let me begin the session by asking two questions to you. Which place is known as the roof of the world? Or which place is known as the Forbidden Kingdom? The answer might have come to you at the very same moment when I said the question. It's an answer that you may find in every GK book that you may prescribe. The answer, without any doubt, is Tibet. Nestled in the heights of the Himalayan landscape, Tibet falls in the Pamir Plateau, the highest plateau on the world. From time immemorial, this land had caught the attention of many travelers, philosophers, religious leaders. The travelers have always wanted to enter this place and explore the terrains. The philosophers were enchanted by the Vajrayana Buddhism that is happening here. And for religion, it is the abode of the Dalai Lama and Tibetan Buddhism. The most prominent image of Tibet that we see is the 86-year-old His Holiness Tenzin Gyatso, the 14th Dalai Lama of Tibet. The word Dalai Lama in Tibetan means the ocean of wisdom. This man is the greatest example of Tibetan and Tibetans living in exile and Tibetan resistance to the Chinese hegemony that we see around us. Now, he received the Nobel Peace Prize in 1989 for his untiring attempts to host the cause of Ahimsa and spread the message of peace and love. And He has been in exile from 1959 onwards, and he is leading the exiled Tibetan government, and he has become the face of Tibet in all over the world. Now, the autocratic policies of the Chinese hegemonic government, which conquered Tibet in 1950 and which had changed, damaged heavily on the culture, nature and the system of Tibet, is continuously saying that this man is a wolf in sheepskin. They have forced the Chinese way of thinking. They have forced the Chinese food. They have forced the Chinese attitude. They have banned the Tibetan idols. They have banned the Tibetan beliefs. They have even stopped the Tibetans to think of what the Tibetan, average Tibetan, would love to have. They have also stopped the worship of the Dalai Lama. They have also stopped the Tibetan Buddhism, and they are bringing in the majority Han Chinese into Tibet and providing them with social secure jobs and banning the Tibetans from doing any job in their own country. However, the Tibetans are not let down by this. They leave their motherland and escape through the killing fields of Chinese People's Liberation Army and march to India. Maybe you may have seen many photographs, many gruesome photographs of the Chinese Tibetan migrants being killed out by the People's Liberation Army for the single cause of leaving the country. They will be either shot up in the Himalayan passes, or they will be brought up before the Chinese government, and in the football fields they will be publicly executed for being, or even for thinking about their faith and their worship of the Dalai Lama and the Buddhist situation. India had become the refuge for Tibetans, and India has educated Tibetans in all ways. The Tibetans say that India is the guru and Tibet is the chela. Chela means the disciple of India. And because India is the disciple, India is the guru, they have accepted India as their second home, and they try to come to India to be educated in the Buddhist faith and then go back to the many, many locations around the world and spread the message of Buddhism and Tibetanness all over the world. Now, we may say that such a situation, where can we find such a situation? Maybe we may find it in Palestine. So, or you may find in many other parts where, or Taiwan. But you cannot say that they are all the same. And there has always been a resistance to the Chinese control. So, we might say that weren't there any kind of resistance in Tibet. Now, to take the account of things, you may say, one can find that there was a kind of resistance, and the name of the resistance was called Chushi Gudrung. Chushi Gudrung was a very popular, prominent resistance movement operated by Chinese, Tibetan nationals, and they were focusing on finishing entire garrisons of Chinese army by just 3 or 4 Tibetans just riding across the mountains and creating a very serious echo and making them think that the Tibetan army is going to kill them off. But they managed to finish off the Chinese garrisons. But owing to his allegiance to Ahimsa, the Dalai Lama never accepted this. And on the request of Dalai Lama, the Chushi Gudrung was stopped, and many of the rebels laid down their arms. And those who had laid down their arms, they were taken up by the Tibetan Chinese operated Tibetan government, and they were taken to the prisons and publicly, most of them publicly executed. But the very few persons who were lucky enough to escape from Tibet moved to India, and they established a world of their own. Now, this had created a gap in their resistance, you may think. But there was no such gap, as there was a change in many of the philosophies, and Tibetans started another kind of resistance. They started setting themselves ablaze, and this is called self-immolation. And till date, we have around 1,000 self-immolations present in the Tibetan community. But the world has not yet publicly renounced the Chinese for making the Tibetans set ablaze themselves. They believe that it's a kind of ahimsa, or it's a kind of a resistance movement, whereby they are able to reduce, they are able to limit the Chinese, or stop the Chinese and remind themselves of the world that they are facing, or telling the world that they are facing such oppression around them. Now, the next phase I will say is that there is another kind of resistance that is coming up in China, coming up in Tibet. And this kind of resistance is basically because of their allegiance to a particular branch of literature, and that branch of literature is none other than poetry. Poetry was always a staple for the Tibetans, because they loved poems, they loved singing, and as their religion was more of a chanting mantra style, they used to develop poetry in such a way that they had poems, they had music in every part of their lives. Poetry for Tibetans was a staple of their life, and poetry was their lifeblood. From the days of their nomadic existence, from the days of their collective existence, from the days of their monastic existence, they used poetry in such a way that poetry was the lifeblood of every Tibetan. From the whistling sounds of the Tibetan plateau, the wind going across, the animals, the birds flying across, you may find that they have found their life expression in the poetry there. Now, Tibetan culture has taken up poetry seriously. Post their migration days, or post their exile days, you may find that the Tibetans have started writing in Tibetan as well as in English. In Tibetan, they express their life's feelings, but in English, they translate it to the greater audience. And as they have started writing in English, the world has come to know that there is a separate country called Tibet, and it is crying for its own existence. Now, let's think about the Tibetan refugees in exile. We have basically 3 generations of exiles. And the first generation of exiles are the set of pioneers who moved out of Tibet and who wanted to build a separate land of themselves. And they did not want to go out of Tibet, but they wanted to make the world know that there are certain changes that are happening around them. And by analyzing that, they wanted to tell the world that, think, there is a country, and this country has not been in war with any person. This country has been forcefully taken, and this country is something for which we have to work on for the sake of humanity, for the sake of peace, for the sake of freedom, for the sake of expression and concern for the other. Now, you have poets who were born in Tibet in the early part of the 20th century, and they had lived a peaceful life till 1950, and because of the Chinese incursion they had to go out of Tibet and they had to establish a land of themselves. So the first generation, you have a set of poets like that, and they started a world of they started writing about Tibet and the Tibet's glorious past. Certain traditions like the Dalai Lama, the belief of the ideal paradise like Shambhala, they came into discussions with these poets. Of these poets, you may say that there are three major poets who had established their role in the exile community. One is Amdo Gendun Chomphel. Amdo Gendun Chomphel is the very first poet who brought out a collection of Tibetan words in English. Then you have Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche. Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche is the very same person who had influenced the Howl poets like Allen Ginsberg and many others. They have changed the world in such a way that the these poets have taken ideas from them, and they have started representing Tibetan ideals in their lives. Same condition with the rock singers like Beatles and others. And the third person, Dhondup Gyal. And to a certain extent, Dhondup Gyal was a person who had never left Tibet. And he lived his entire life in Tibet, being a refugee in his own homeland. But Dhondup Gyal, in his 34th year of life, he committed suicide, and he had published a wonderful work called The Waterfall of Life. Just like the clear water running Tibetan waterfalls, Dhondup Gyal tells us about how life is, what life is, and how life had changed because of the Chinese incursion. Now, let's take the second generation of Tibetan exiles. And these were poets. Basically, almost all of the Tibetan exiles were poets. So that is why I am using the term poets than exiles. Many of them have written their poems with their lives, not more than their literary output. Now, these poets of the second generation, they were actually born around 1940s, and they had to leave the Tibet from in their very little infancy. They were born in 1940s, 50s, or even to the extent of they were born between 60s and 70s. They had to leave Tibet and had to fled to India. And from India, they set up a land where they were born, and they passed on the real wish of many Tibetans to go back to their country. Now, when you visit a Tibetan of the first and second generations, they will serve you well with tea, especially their salted butter tea called Po Cha, and you will have it, you will be very happy to have it. They will be very happy to have you, they have you there. They will tell you about their lives in Tibet and things like that. And once you finish your food, what they will do is that they will clean their utensils and pack them off for the next day. Normally, what we do here is that we don't pack our utensils, we don't pack our clothes every day to go somewhere. But these persons have been packing off their utensils and clothes for the last 50 years, hoping that they may one day go back to Tibet from the very first days of exile. The world governments had promised Tibetans that they could send the Tibetans back to their homeland in a very short time. But the undeciding characters of the world leaders, they had changed the situation, and for the last 60 to 70 years, Tibetans still are in exile, and generations are born in exile who don't know about their Tibetan past, who don't know about their life in as an independent country. Now, the second generation, you have most important poets of the group are K. Dhondup, Lasang Siring and Gyalpo Siring, Nagdo Paljor, Soltim Shakapa, Gendun Chomphel Jr., properly mostly called as GC. Then you have Tenzing Sonam and Norbu Sangpo. Among these writers, two names I would like to highlight on two names, Lasang Siring and Gyalpo Siring. Both of them were members of the Chushi Gudring. So they knew their representations of the world they knew about Tibet and outside are entirely different from the existing setup. Then you have Soltim Shakapa, the son of a very affluent Tibetan minister just before the Chinese incursion. and his father's passport, which the Tibetan government gave, and many of the world, the countries of the world had given him access to travel across Europe, England, India, and many parts of the world, even to America. So this was a very crucial tool which had shown the world that Tibet was an independent country and not under the Chinese governance as the Chinese had claimed. The Chinese had always said that Tibet has to return to its motherland, but Tibet is a independent, is an independent country, and there is no return to the motherland. So these writers, they have shown the reality of exile, and they have represented more than the first generation writers. They were focusing on the reality of exile, and they wanted to spread the message that exile is something that they wish to go back, but the whole world is against them. Now, it is with them that the world had expressed, that the world had understood that there is still time to reconsider the real facts of understanding Tibet. Now, after them, we have the third generation of Tibetans. The third generation of Tibetans, from here onwards, you have the most current generation of Tibetans who were born from 1970s to 1990s. They were basically born in the roadside labor camps, and they were not, they have not seen Tibet, and they have heard of Tibet only as a place of their forefathers and their origin. They have only understood Tibet as a mystical landscape, and they don't know that whether they will ever go back to Tibet, but the same spirit of return is still with them, and they are ready to accept any challenge to go back to Tibet. There have been efforts to return to Tibet, to walk back to Tibet, but blocked by the governments all across the world, and because they don't want the wrath of China happening on them. Now, among them, you have very important poets like Tenzin Sundu, Siring Wangpo Dhompa, Buchungdi Sonam, Topten Chakrishar, Katup Siring, Topden Siring, Samcho Dolma, Tenzin Trinle, Tenzin Gelek, Kalsang Wangdu, Ujjain Chofel, Namgil Funsok, Sherab V. Chofel, Gur Gyal, Tenzin Plasun, Dawa Vosar, Wangchung Siring, Siring Dholkar, Dharil Siring, Pema Tenzin, and Cherin Norbu and Siring Dorje. Now, these writers, they wanted to show other world that these Tibet, their lives in exile is actually ruining their hopes, or representing, they wanted to experience, they wanted to represent the world, or be a living testimony before the world, saying that this is our homeland and this is how the Chinese are ruining their homeland. These were the writers who were in the forefront of many of the protests against the Chinese government. These were the writers who were jeopardized by the reality of not going back. If the first and second generations, they wished to, or they always dreamed of going back, the third generation now says that there may be a chance of going back. Now, we have a fourth generation coming up, the post-millennial generation of 2000s rising in the Tibetan landscape. And we may say that they are the ones who are most disillusioned by it, because it's a Tibet that their parents have not seen. It's only a story their parents, their grandparents had said. You may not find that Tibet anymore. You may say that Tibet is there, but that Tibet is inaccessible. Whenever they try to go back, whenever they ask the countries where they have taken refuge, they are second-rate citizens. There is no citizen's rights for them. Now, the poems in exile of Tibetan poets discusses the existence of Tibet against the realities of exile. Thus, they have rooted their poems and lives in exile with a specific religious and political identity, a desire to return, a right to exist and express, and a strong hope of a better future, and a voicing of the political orphanness they are facing today. The harsh realities have really added up to their experience of the Tibetans. This makes their poetry even more potent, and this is a kind of resistance against the Chinese rule. This is not an armed resistance. This is a penned resistance. and with the pen, which is mightier than the sword, they are challenging the Tibetan authorities, who have or the Chinese are rulers in Tibet. And it is often said that the one who controls Tibet will become the next prime minister or the president of China. The best example is Hu Jintao or the Xi Jinping, who rules China. They were administrators of Tibet. The ability of the administrator to quell down the riots, the problems of Tibet, is highly appreciated in their selection to the next category. So here, these persons outside Tibet is voicing the issues of Tibet. Now, of these poets, what one single poet I would like to present in detail, and that poet is Tenzin Sundu. Sundu can be rightfully called as the father of modern Tibetan poetry in English. And it is Sundu's poetry that has changed the whole set of understanding of Tibetan poetry. He uses his exile as a tool to spread the message of Tibet inside and outside India, where he has taken his refuge. He tours, his touring lectures in India and abroad has changed the understanding of the whole set of people who discuss about Tibet. He has received, revived the interest in Tibetan poets of the past and present, and to a great extent, he is definitely a future icon for many of the younger Tibetan poets also. His famous poem, Horizon, tells us about the reality of, harsh reality of exile, and the harsh reality of not going back. Let me quote a few lines from his poem, The Horizon. The poem goes like this, Horizon. From home you have reached the horizon here. From here to another, here you go. From there to the next, next to the next, horizon to horizon. Every step is a horizon. Count the steps, keep the number, pick the white pebbles and the funny strange leaves, mark the curves and cliffs around, for you may need to come home again. This coming home again was a concept they deeply wanted, but it's like the horizon. They will never come home, but they are always trying to come home. That is why they are taking the pebbles and marking the marks on the rocks and the trees, so that one day, may not be in their own lifetime, maybe in another life, or maybe in their children's lives, they may try to return. And when they try to return, these marks might help them to go back. Since they are living in exile for so long, they also fear that there will not be any marks of their households, which they had to leave one stark cold night because of the Chinese incursion, will be there to for them to understand, to realize and to go back. Now, another exile poet, Buchungdi Sonam, in his poem Banishment, now see the title, he uses the term as banishment, you are banished out of the land. He writes thus, away from home, my minutes are hours, spider travels from the window to the ceiling, bee flies from the window to the bin, I stare out of the window, neither speaks of each other's tongue, I wish you would go deaf before my silence. Now, he uses the image of the bee and the spider spinning web. But normally we have so much we have been so much attracted to the idea of King Bruce. We say that seeing the spider building the web, King Bruce had actually been motivated enough to use the idea and to works hard and again. So he won the battle against the English. But here the story is not like that. The spider and the bee are doing their part. They have finished their part. When I, the Tibetan, tries to cry out my cries, the whole world, that's the you who keep on silence, and as you keep silence, I am thinking that I am all alone, and I wish that your silence is so deafening. It is not a problem if you were deaf, but you pretending deaf becomes a big problem for me. Now let me take one last example also. This example is from Gendun Chofel Jr., or affectionately called GC, another young Tibetan poet who died in his early 40s. He tells the same as his in his poem The Exile. I feel myself standing in the wilderness, cold, alone, empty, beauty all around me, pain constricting my heart. The road of life lies long and empty, and no balm exists to smooth me of this lost and sunken heart. You may find many renderings of the English poems here, but the idea that is penned here is entirely different. And in this, through this idea, they want to tell us that I am an orphan who is standing in the crossroads of life. I can't go further, and there is no one to help me to put balm on my pains. And this inability of the whole set has changed the world in such a way that I am unable to understand why the world is not with me. Thus, poetry of Tibet becomes a very sharp tool to represent the lives. And by representing the lives, they really want to challenge us always. Come, look, understand that we are here. Don't be deaf. Don't be afraid to tell the world that China is suppressing us. Stand by us. Be with us. So, poetry becomes the most potent tool of resistance for the Tibetans. And it is not like the gun. The pen has conquered the world in a much better manner. Thank you.